Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Community Crossfire, another point of view. I'm your host, Stormy Norman Oliver. I have my good friend, I will call him Dr. Sonny Vaccaro. Sonny has brought so many people together in this country. He's done so many incredible things, and especially for the people here in the state of Delaware, and I'm honored. I had an opportunity to talk to Brother Berkeley, Brother Chris, Brother John Carlos, all these guys from out of Atlanta because of my good friend, Sonny Vaccaro. If you got a chance to watch the 3030 Soul Man, this is that guy. He's a guy who brought a lot of young grassroots people in, like Gary Childs and myself, into Nike, Adidas. I mean, and a lot of times, and I'm just going to set the stage, Sonny, and I'm going to come to you. People look at it as just basketball, but this guy's world and what he's done for so many people around the country, and people now, judges, doctors, lawyers, business people, I mean, and it goes on and on. And I'm just honored that he's been a friend, a mentor, a father, a brother. And he and I sometimes been on the phone, got emotional because of our love. How you doing, Sonny?
Norman, I'm doing well. It's been a long year, obviously with a lot of personal things within my family and worldly things across the country and all countries. I've never experienced, and I'm 81 years old, the turmoil and the backfire of a lot of things that were taken for granted. And I, as you mentioned, I love being associated with, you know, the sports and the basketball and people like yourself. But what I got to say at the top of your program, a long time ago, an awful long time before anyone that's watching us probably, you know, Sonny Vaccaro is grateful to all the parents and guardians of all the children that they allowed to play in my events. I didn't know one single person in the 1960s. And basically, these people, the guardians and the parents, trusted me with their children. And most of them, because it was the sport of basketball that started my life, Norman, were African-American, colored, Negroes, whatever it was, they were human beings and people. And I'll never forget how Sonny Vaccaro got started, ever. And where we are today is, I don't know what we've made progress in since I started basically doing what I was doing in the 1960s. I hope that's understood correctly by your audience. But what I'm saying is the country and the people within the country have come a long way, but we're not even close to a finish line.
Hey, Sonny,
81 years, well, then you can talk. 81 years, and I've never had a worse year in my life.
I'm sorry to hear that, Sonny. Sonny, we jumped a little bit. Could you take us how you got involved, and we're gonna come all the way up to here, right? But I think people need to hear some stories, right? From, I mean, Dapper Dan, where you from? You know, in Pennsylvania, how did you grow up? If you could just take us on a little journey, like you don't have to talk about your whole life story, but I think people don't know the Sonny Vaccaro at 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. They know the Sonny from 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, now 81. You understand what I'm saying? If you could just...
Yes, I do. I think, Norman, what I can say and get to the point quickly is when I grew up, the World War, the Second World War, just over. And my family on both sides of the aisle, my dad's side and my mother's side, were involved in the Second World War. Hmm. So I started in 1939, 81 years ago when I was born. And I'm still here. And what I've seen and what happened to me at that age, I understand what hurt is. Mm-hmm. I understand what bad things can happen to people that can't fend for themselves in a short period of time. I've been put in a situation where my background allowed me to have strength because of my mother and dad. And in those days, the world is as much as we understand, you know, the beginning of time and all the bad things have happened. And I'm talking to you in a community where bad things have happened to Black people all my life and before my life and before my ancestors. But then it's 50s and 60s after the Second World War, and I'll get past that quickly. I witnessed it. Mm-hmm. And I found out one thing. The only integrity we have is the one that God gave us that's really inside of us, that all people are equal. all people have ways of suffering inside of them. And family is the strongest strength that you can have. And that's what allowed me to be a free thinker. As I grew, went to college, and all the things that I have on a resume that means nothing other than this is what happened to me. The one thing that's consistent in my life, and your listenership should understand, I never knew what I was going to do until I did it. I went to college, I wasn't intended. I was never, in his 50s, small Italian kids with immigrant parents didn't go to college. I wanted to play baseball. All these things transferred themselves to a continuous ride. I believed through the grace of God, because I totally believe in God, but I believed in my family. I believed in them because why? They allowed this first son of theirs to have a free mind. So when I say to your audience, I swear to God, I never knew there'd be a Dapper Dan game. I didn't grow up wanting to have an all-star game in Pittsburgh in 1965. That happened because I was going through my life and I was in an accident. I was in graduate school and college. I couldn't continue. So I dropped out of getting my master's. And all of a sudden I thought about all those kids I was taking around to all the tournaments in that Western Pennsylvania area. That's how it started. Then I used to send, it was letters and make phone calls. I didn't fly around and see all the kids those first 5 and 10 years. It wasn't like today where you got the internet. I made a phone call and I asked to send Norman Oliver to the Pittsburgh Dapper Dan from Los Angeles, California. And mom and dad, Oliver, put their child on a plane to come to Pittsburgh. They'd never been on a plane.
Hey, Sonny, explain to people what the Dapper Dan Classic was. See, I'm trying to... For people who know, right, they're going to know. But there's a lot of people who watch this show around the country. And some people, we just got to explain to them exactly what we're talking about.
Norman, in 1965, all those people that don't know, just go back and try and find an all-star game that encapsulized America. Mm. Because what I did, I invited people from all the 49 other states to play against the state of Pennsylvania in the new Civic Arena. 10,000 people. I didn't have 5 cents. My partner, Pat DeCesar, had 10 cents. And so we went to the newspaper. I said, I got an idea. That's how it started. And the idea mushroomed into all the things you see after that. I got people to come to Pittsburgh. Then I got 10,334 people to buy a ticket to a game in 1965. Now understand, Pittsburgh in 1965, they weren't playing basketball other than high school. No one was going to school on basketball scholarships. Well, most of the people in your audience know that the greatest basketball players in the 50s and 60s were black, and they were forced to go to black colleges. Mm-hmm. So there wasn't this open, festival we're going to have, and we're going to go to a buffet dinner, and we're going to pick out. I read books, and I found out that this kid was good in California. This kid was good in New York. I read Parade magazine. That's how I invited people.
Was it one or two players that came to play and you said, oh, wow, we're on our way? Who was like the first superstar that played you?
Well, the first one was a great game. And we had kids that didn't turn out to be the greatest, but we had 7 of them go to the NBA after that. But the guy that made the All-Star games, and just so your audience knows, we were 13 years ahead of McDonald's.
Oh, wow.
13 years, 1977. When they had theirs, and they wanted me to run it, and I wouldn't run it because I didn't take any money from the Dapper Dan, and it wasn't bad. They did the right thing. They hired people to do it, and honestly, the only one your audience knows now is the McDonald's. They weren't 13 years. We were the only game in town. But Calvin Murphy.
Well, okay.
Calvin Murphy from Norwich, Connecticut. Five feet 9'10".
That's right.
In a little Italian kid from Farrell, Pennsylvania. And Farrell, Pennsylvania was very good in the state of Pennsylvania in those years. They had great teams, run state championship. Another little kid, 5'11". They put on a show that because they were both teeny. But Calvin did something that Sammy couldn't do. He dunked. He was the first person that I would say that originated the dunk.
I didn't know Calvin Murphy could dunk.
Big guys do it, maybe in the pros. We saw Will do it. We never saw Calvin Murphy do it. And what he did that night and what Sammy did, 10,000 people saw. And then when they enlarged that arena in 1977, we had 17,000 people coming to the Civic Arena in Pittsburgh. We had a game where I had double headers of East, West, North, and South. What we did was improvise. But just so the audience understands, it was all about the kids and the public. And Pittsburgh didn't know a damn about basketball.
So after that, is that when a sneaker company started picking up on your ideals, or was it something in between?
The sneaker company was an afterthought. The whole Nike facade, whatever. Okay. I started when I did the Dapper Dan about 3 years into it, 1968 or 69, there was a resort in Western Pennsylvania called Seven Springs Mountain Resort. It was a ski resort, still in effect. Seven Springs. And I went to a lawyer friend of mine, Jimmy Morocco, in Trafford. Trafford only had 4,000 people. I only had 53 kids in my graduating class, just so we understand that. And I said, why don't we do a camp where we can make money? So I put a camp called it the Big Ten Camp in Seven Springs. We laid our own asphalt. We made two courts. We used the dormitories that the skiers use in the winter. Mm-hmm. And that's what happened, because you know how Nike happened, Norman? The people knowing. I was going up, it was going to lunch or something. And I don't remember the kid's name, but this is gospel. I don't remember his name, but I'll call him Charlie. I was going up one day and we were going to lunch, I guess. And Charlie comes over to me and Charlie says, Mr. Vaccaro, yeah, Charlie, how can I help you? How come they don't make tennis shoes I can wear to the school, I can wear to church? Why are they always the dirty? Because the reason was they wear them outside on the dirt where the kids were playing. It was more for outside, and the poor kids wore tennis shoes. I had tennis shoes, okay? So he asked me, that was a great idea. He said, they should make tennis shoes. That's how it started. I knew a lawyer friend in New York who was representing players at that time, Lou Schaffel and Jerry Davis. If any of your people want to go back, they would have one of the first group of major, major guys. They had Tiny Archibald and a million other people. They started to know me because I was actually, Norman, in the early 70s, I was hired by the ABA to introduce him to those kids that played in the first five or six round ball classics, the kids I told you about, Kenny Durrett, Larry Cannon, Simi Hill, Bob. I mean, we got over and over great, great pros. Dana Lewis from New Jersey. I mean, and they said if I could introduce him, and I'd get the kid, all I did was introduce him. But Steve or Marty and Jerry, coordinated me. And so he gave me a credit card, and I saw all the kids that played my round ball, Leon Douglas. And I'd go to the campus in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. I hadn't seen him since round ball, right? I was still this strange white guy.
Hey, Sonny, can I stop you for 1 second?
Yeah.
But because most of us in our neighborhoods were wearing Converse, and Converse was introduced to a lot of our neighborhoods. So that's why I'm getting confused at. That's why I'm like, how did...
Converse ran the world. But I kicked their ass, and they don't run it anymore. In fact, Nike bought 30 years later. My point to you is there is pro kids. There was
right.
Yeah. So these people, and they gave me shoes for the round ball kids. So I asked, and I all they did was give me the shoes. It wasn't like today, the sponsorship and give you $100,000. But the round ball was just his thing. But Charlie gave me an idea. So I went to an Italian shoemaker friend named Bobby Di Rinaldo, who grew up to be in the Shoemakers Hall of Fame. Swear to God. Now, he created for me a tennis shoe, leather, white leather, cut holes in it, made a disco shoe, put those little sprinkles on, 7 or 8 pair of shoes that I took to Nike, not for them to get all the Dapper Dan or pros. Pros weren't big in 77, 78, Norman. Yeah, remember up till like the 80s when Magic played, they won the first, it was tape delayed, the NBA. There's no Final Four. There are 32 teams. It was all political than it is now. But my point here is, so basketball is an afterthought, and especially in Pennsylvania, where football. You grew up with football and baseball. Basketball is the third sport. So I go out, I show Nike, Phil Knight, Rob Strasser, my benefactor at Nike, and Phil Knight. I go out there, and I had a potato sack. That's what they're called, because everyone had a garden in Western Pennsylvania. And you'd go to the garden and you'd have the potato sack and you'd put the lettuce in there, the tomatoes. That's how we'd carry them. And we'd put them on our back, because it was never like our yards weren't big enough. We didn't have big yards, but there was always a patch of land somewhere in Trafford or across the bridge. Everyone had a garden. It was all immigrants. They all had gardens, okay? Now, I take them to Nike. I give them to them. They said they wanted to look at them. I never got them back. I'm telling you, I had Velcro. Bobby put Velcro on them. You know what Velcro is. Bobby was ahead of his time. They kept them. Then they got interested in the Dapper Dan, and that's when the world changed. Because by then, that's when they went to the Dapper Dan. It's now 1976, 77. You know, they give me all the shoes. They hadn't given me any money but shoes. Strauss comes back and sees the Dapper Dan. That year we had 17,000 people. He did it. After that is when I went and said to them, you guys want to get involved in basketball? You know, give me the shoes. Give me a couple of dollars for the round ball. But pay the coaches. That's Nike. No one had anything to do with anything except Sonny Vaccaro. This is fact. You know, all the bullshit that they run. This is how it happened. And you can't make the story up, because there's nobody named at that time that even knew who Nike was. Mm. So that's how it happened. So we signed 80 some head coaches, including John Thompson and Jimmy Valvano and all the guys who were, we had four or five the first year.
How did you sign them?
Pardon me?
How did you sign them?
I give him a contract and I said, I'm going to pay you $5,000. That's what it was then.
Wow.
And I gave him I wrote my own check. Nike didn't believe I could do it. Then they wired it in. You're too young to remember. They wired it in. In those days, it was called kiting a check, which meant you had 5 or 6 days before that check actually got there in the sale. It ain't like today. You get a check today. I was a professional kiting checks. Okay. I was in college. I was delivering. I was buying 4 or 5 days. I'd, you know, cash up for a couple $100 and pray to God that I found a couple $100 to deposit it. Okay.
Right, right.
I had a lot of friends that liked me in those banks and said, Sonny, you got a check here. A lot of those. Okay. I had a lot of friends that helped me all my life. So this is how it gets there. So to bring this up to where you're probably picked me up. Michael Jordan doesn't happen unless Nike owns all the colleges, just so we understand that. It's all bullshit. They had no team. They had Oregon. That's what they had. If I don't go, they still don't have anybody. So we're going to just put that on a table, but I want to go past that, and you ask me some questions. So it all happened because a kid asked me, Mr. Vaccaro, because he was embarrassed, can you make a tennis shoe that I can wear to school or to church? He was embarrassed. Converse owned everything. When we were done, Nike ended up buying Converse. And you know that. Nike still runs the world.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're getting it here first from the great Sonny Vaccaro, a good friend of mine, a mentor. This is Community Crossfire, Another Point of View, and we're going to get an in-depth conversation with Sonny Vaccaro. And we're going to keep, and we're going to let him bring it to us as he would like, because this is open. We talk like this. Okay, Sonny, so now you got, I mean, I remember, of course, when you in grassroots basketball, you have to know Mr. Vaccaro. I'm in Denver, Colorado. I think it was 98, 99. I forget when it was. It was the Final Fours. It was Duke against UNLV. And you are being interviewed by Ted Koppel. Ted Koppel, I remember. And I said, this guy is fascinating. I said, and you and I run into each other coming down the hall. I said, I agree with everything you said. But it seems like it started being a little controversial. Like people were calling you like a basketball pimp, or you're pimping the community. All these adjectives that has nothing to do with what you were doing in helping our community. How did that make you feel? And what do you think today?
How that made me feel? The same way I think today. They're hypocrites and they're liars. And I've called them that for many years. One guy was John Feinstein. One of the great one of the great writers in America. He wrote Bobby Knight. He wrote this one. And he's a good writer, I guess. He sells a lot of books. But there were some people that accused me of doing something that would be stupid, but they must be stupid other than they write books. And I'm saying this to your program and to the people watching here, is what it made me feel like was that I did have a bigger mission than what I thought I did. Okay. My bigger mission was, I've got to do what I can do as an individual. I can't let people interpret my life for me. So anytime, and that's the reason why I'm on, you know, the 10 most wanted people, but I'm all 10 of them in America with the NCAA. There is no other poster. It's just my picture. Okay. Mm-hmm. And that's fine. That's fine. But the reason I can do this, Norman, is I can look you in the eye and the people listening and watching the show and not worry about the answer, because I dare them to contradict me with facts. And what I can also dare is what they should understand, that if you tell the truth, then you have nothing to worry about. The ones that have to worry about is the ones that, you know, make things up as they go along because it's personal. And we see that where we are today. And if I can fast forward, and if you allow me to indulge me,
please do.
Where this president took us, he tore America apart because he lied. Norman Oliver, I want to tell you and your listeners and watchers, okay? I believe in my heart of hearts that the hardest thing a human being has to overcome is a lie put out and perpetrated by someone who is very powerful and has the wherewithal to do what they want to continue the lie. See, what happens on most lies and most people's lives is the person who's being lied about very seldom has the resources to counter and stand up for himself. My resource has just been me and the opportunity to talk to people, because I made a vow to my mother and dad a long time ago. It may not have been a vow like you think a vow is, but bring it up. My dad would always say to me after I did something wrong, Norman, Juwan, you think you do the right thing? I said, yeah, Daddy, I do. He said, okay, I believe you. I'll never forget that. Mm-hmm. And I always thought I did the right thing. So all the people that start the lies, they have to continue the lie. Well, if they attack me, I'll never, ever give them a chance to, first of all, you know, prove otherwise, because I'm not afraid of what the hell they would say. And I'll fight back. And I fought back. It's very interesting, and your audience should know this. It might be the most important thing I say to your audience. I've been a single individual my whole life. I worked for corporations, and we both did well. I made more money than I thought I would, and they paid me well and all that sort of stuff. But they made billions and billions, and that's what my job was. That's what it was. So I did well. And I worked for all of them. But the best job I ever had was a non-paying job, when I helped get Brandon Jennings to fight the system and go to Europe. Mm-hmm. I helped Eddie O'Bannon go. I wasn't Brandon's agent. I wasn't all in Eddie's thing. And I spoke at 48 schools across America, espousing the virtues. And we're right in the middle of it right now. It's current, because yesterday the NCAA, for the 10,000th time, to me, the NCAA is one of the most guilty institutions ever put before mankind. And I'm going to say to you, for the life of me, only because the greed continues, everything they've done for the 1900s, 1920, and I don't want to go through that with your audience, I'll lose them. But they were all rules, not laws, made to enhance the coffers of the people running the NCAA and the coaches and the commissioners and the president. I don't know what the hell Mark Armour does for $3 million a year. What does he do, schedule games? I have no idea. But they award themselves money. And the athlete today, just come out. We're going to go to the Alston case with Jeff Kessler, like the O'Bannon with Michael Hosfield. We're going to court. O'Bannon with Michael Hosfield put in antitrust. Antitrust, and you know this, Norm, because you're a businessman, is one of the worst legal things you can do, because people want to own everything. Mm-hmm. And they do everything to keep all the money themselves. That's what it is. It's the greed. They don't want anybody else doing anything. Mm. So what I've been able to do, and let me say this again before I go one step further. Where did this start? In 1968, when I was in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Trafford, little hometown, okay? I saw John, Carlos, and Tommy Smith. stand up in New Mexico. I didn't know what the hell they were doing. Mm-hmm. I really didn't. We didn't have TV like we did today. Mm-hmm. All we had were the few stories, and then they extirpated them, and they just destroyed their lives. But they were the first to stand up. Now we've had others, Dr. King and Muhammad Ali. We've had many, many people. But if you're honest about this, John Carlos and Tommy Smith stood up for it to everybody, because no one was doing that. The Olympic Committee with all their Avery Bungees and the Nazis and all shit. They got excommunicated.
And look at the relationship that you and John Carlos have now. Look at you guys' relationship. Look how the world comes together.
It took me 30 years to meet John personally. But my point is, let me just finish this on John. He motivated me, because after that, I give you chapter and verse for what happened in the 70s. You know why the NCAA went to 4 years and cut it down to one? Because all the black players, it was a black power movement. It was all those guys who were going to take over America and all this stuff. Every white guy in America was thinking that was going to happen, whatever it was, okay? But they were doing what is being done today, fighting for that right. But they didn't have the background to fight. But what happened? Where all these black athletes were going to these schools, they start, especially in the Northwest, Wyoming and Colorado State and all that. A lot of those kids were starting to boycott. A lot of those kids were starting to fight back at the NCAA. That's when they took the four-year scholarship away. That's when they took it. John and Tommy started a movement that started everything. And that's that. Where are we today? First of all, when you're honoring people, you ought to start in this segment of their lives. There's 70s, 80s, they're almost at the end of their line, okay, to be very honest with you. How the heck do we not do it until recently? I know how we did it, because John and Tommy caused an uproar over the whole world and everyone that followed. And if you look at it, in that one there, they had a white kid from Australia that stood up there with them and bowed his head and had the medal on. And Jim Brown told me something on a personal level. I'll never forget that we were in another one of those meetings, and Jim was with me. It was Black and White in America. Ted Cobble hosted that too. And Jim came to me and he said to me, and I'll never forget this, because obviously the world knows who Jim Brown is. And Jim was a tough, strange character, but man, he had principles and he was different than the rest. White, green, purple, and whatever. Jimmy did what Jimmy wanted. So he walked away from football and all that stuff. But tell you what he told me. He said to me, Sonny, he said, the problem with the world, in every movement we've had, there was always white people that stepped up and helped us. And go back to Dr. King. And he brought it up and he said, if you look in those days, though, and Jimmy told me this, he said, they were mostly entertainers. Very few athletes stood up. Go back and look at the marches. It was mostly entertainers. And today, the entertainers are the greatest, most of them are black. And look where the young kids that I know, look where LeBron is. I can only use LeBron because I knew him as a child. What he's doing is what I think he was brought on earth for. I mean that, because I knew him young, and to watch what he's doing and to watch what some of these other kids are doing, that wasn't happening before. So I'm going to talk to your audience and tell them that what needs to be done now. Mr. Biden is now president. You know what? That's a nice title. That really is. And Joe is way ahead of what this horrible human being was. But if he doesn't get help, we're going to be back in the same thing, because this person who was president is going to continue to ruin it. I've never in my adult life, and I'll be finished with my politics, I apologize. But never in my adult life have I ever thought, I always believed there was racism, even in 68. And to be very honest with you, there was racism between the nationalities too. And the blacks were always the last ones. Some had their fights, public, privately. And that's where I watched. That's what I said to myself a long time ago. So when I watch all these kids today, it does my heart good. So I don't know. Take me off this subject.
So can let me interject for 1 second. No, I'm not going to take you off the subject. First of all, we in the state of Delaware appreciate all you've done. And people in the state have no idea how much you've done for Joe Biden's election. The meetings and the Zoom calls you have with me and Gary Childs and so many others around the country, the phone calls you have with Brian McGlinchey and so many other people around the country, the calls that you had in Pittsburgh and in Pennsylvania and in Chicago, Detroit. I mean, you played a major role. And I remember, and we could talk about this, when Joe Biden was a U.S. senator, he sent you a key and a proclamation to the state of Delaware. People don't know that. So we do have to talk about that because that's important to this discussion. And we can't take that for granted. And we are very humble and appreciative because it started way before this. It started before he was a vice president. You know, he was a young man. He knew of Sonny Vaccaro. And I remember being in his office. And he was like, Norm, wow, I'm honored to send this to Sonny Vaccaro. And I'm not sure if you still had that key or proclamation, but he sent it to you then. So we got to talk about that. But I do want to stay on basketball for 1 second, right? Two of the most iconic 20th century people in basketball, Sonny Vaccaro and Michael Jordan. It may be painful. Something happened because now I see where you're auctioning off a pair of shoes that were for $500,000, $700,000. I don't know what you're going to get for it. What happened with that relationship? Because you said at one point there wouldn't be a Michael Jordan. And I don't want to stay on Michael Jordan because he's just one person in this whole ram. But in my mind, you are two of the most iconic basketball figures in the 21st century.
Well, what happened, my relationship with
Michael Jordan. And I thought you should have been on that that thing that they were showing, The Last Dance. So that's a whole nother thing.
It's a very thing because Michael will live to regret what he and Phil Knight and George Raveling. You know the fable and the famous thing, there's a Judas Priest in everyone's life, and we know who the most famous Judas was, right?
Right.
George Raveling was mine. George Raveling was my best man in my life.
That's horrible. I know the story.
It's not only horrible, it's pathetic. But the reason I say that, because what Phil Knight and Michael Jordan did, they got together with George Raveling, and they concocted something that's totally, totally impossible to prove. Because I will say to you and your audience, I traveled the world with Michael.
Listen.
My wife Pam's birthday was on the same day. I got that shoe I have, that was something that Michael gave me personally. Mm. I mean, we weren't even at the game. He left it at the game and sat there for 7 days. Can you imagine a Jordan shoe sitting in it? Because Pam and I were on vacation in 1992. I never would have sold it until the circumstances now. Never. But what happened was because of where we are in the world today, they want to they want to rewrite history, and I won't let them do it.
But why did they want to cut you out, Sonny? Why? Well,
because I'm not the person they want. Norman, without me and Phil Knight and Rob Strasser coming to me, hiring me and getting college, forget Michael. I got 80 schools. We had all four in the Final Four by 1984. I had John Thompson, you know, Raleigh Massimino. We had all four of those, Louis Conseca. No, I mean, Nike didn't have anybody in 1978. And 6 years later, we had the whole Final Four. Okay. What happened there, Norman, what happened? If we weren't successful, just your public listen to what I'm going to say. We wouldn't have had any money to give Michael Jordan. Because if you go back to when they hired me, I think they had $25 million in revenues. They were a track and field company. The University of Oregon with Dick Carter there. They had to like give them the shoes. I mean, no one was wearing basketball shoes. Okay? And then all of a sudden, I've been everywhere. I don't want to go into it here. I can't. But I just want your audience to understand. I was with Michael when he was the first athlete to be on Saturday Night Live and broke all the records at that time. Hmm. I produced a show on NBC. I was a co-producer.
This is deep.
The Jordan show, the Jordan special. It's impossible to erase me, but they chose to lie. Now, I'm going to give you an example, and I want your audience to understand it.
Listen.
Don't use me for anything other than I'm giving you an analogy of what I thought was one of the turning points in my life in reacting the way I'm reacting. I read The Diary of Anne Frank when I was very young, in my 20s or 30s. I mean, I just did. In fact, Norman, I don't think I've ever read a fiction book in my life. And if you go to my library, you'll find a unbelievable record collection of some of the greatest recordings of all time from the greatest artist of all time, but not one particular set, from country music to blues to Lead Belly to whoever it was. I love music and I love facts. So when you go and see that, so why am I saying this? Well, Nazi Germany had to be the most horrible thing in the world. Nothing's worse than enslavement. But enslavement and slavery and blacks from Africa taken here and being sold was the biggest sin of mankind. And then we had all those sins before us when there wasn't an America. Man against man had been making sins, you know, I can't explain, but forever. But stay on what I'm going to tell you. But Anne Frank, I don't know why in the hell I read that, except it was interesting. And so I wanted to know, I didn't see no movies or whatever. I read this book, didn't really understand until I understood. But why? What I'm saying to you, it took me 20 years to understand where I was going with that time I read them in the 70s, I guess, or 80s. I don't know when that little, got the paper book yet, paperback of that book yet, was this. Okay. If that girl don't go in the attic and write those words in that attic, and somehow those words on a tablet paper, whatever hell it was saved throughout the other refugees, the other people in that attic, and it didn't get destroyed in the book burnings, it was probably the only book that wasn't destroyed by the Nazis. It survived. When you say, because I don't like bringing God into it, I believe God allows us to make our own decision, but someone protected that book. If we don't find the Diary of Anne Frank, all it is a story that's magnified over the years. But we probably would have forgot. Why do we forget, Norman? Because everybody else in the family was killed. They were all wiped out. They were all put in a concentration camp. But the book lived. So I'm saying to you, truth and lies go together. If someone has power, I'm not connecting the people I'm fighting here with Nazi Germany. I'm only saying they're the most powerful people in the world. Just think of who I'm talking about.
Hey, Sonny, I'm you know, you got me thinking, right? And let me get your opinion on this. Do you think that movement that you guys had, right, really sounds to me like it really affected like the CIAA and historically black colleges, because they didn't have the wherewithal, right, or like the sneaker deals then.
Right.
And now the better basketball players start going to these big colleges. And I never thought about this. To just now, to this conversation, I swear I never thought about that. Do you think that that's had an impact on HBCUs? Because you remember the CIAA, those was the big tournaments back then.
Let me correct you.
Okay.
Sonny Vaccaro, just like I gave to Norman Oliver in the 1990s.
That's right.
Gave shoes to David Whitney and about 10 of the black college coaches, you know, and they were all that time, we didn't call it, you know, historically, you know, they were just black.
Right.
Black schools, okay? Uh-huh. And the greatest coaches in the world were in that league, you know. Had big guys gains. I mean, we can go over forever, right?
Uh-huh.
Never had jobs. So I'm proud to tell you, it's fact. I'm not fabricating. Mm-hmm. I got proof, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it never entered my mind, ever. Like when I sent you the shoes, and I sent a lot of other people, I picked a guy, good guy, didn't I?
Well,
I
didn't. You changed.
Stop. I'll tell you why. Look what you grew up to be. What you did with the turkey drive, what you do with your personal life, you went through your own personal tragedies, and you rose to the top. Mm-hmm. You rose to the top, and you're like friends with the president of the United States.
Mm.
That day, I didn't know whatever. And I remember I come to Delaware, and I think I met every congressman and thing, and I was fighting for Brandon Jennings then, Oh, Brandon wasn't on. You took me everywhere. And I went down and I found the guys that I got the cards from. I still have the cards, all these people I met. There's only two that never answered me. And I get personal. I really do. I give you a chance and you don't have to, but I went back a second time to one guy and he's a big shot now. And they never responded.
Is that Cory Booker?
I'm not going to tell you. It has nothing to do with anything right now. But my point to you is, if there's a philosophy that you should have as an individual, allow your opposition, allow your adversaries to at least come to grips. Don't have to agree, but respect the person. And just say, you know what? I don't believe in what you're doing. Nothing wrong with that. Damn. I made a million mistakes.
So we talk. Is there any sports figure, right, besides Jim Brown that came through or entered into your life that you like, wow, inspired you?
I think they all did, because they're all around kids. And then I watched them grow up and to be men. And I watched tragic things. I can sit here and tell you the ones that were great ended up on drugs and died early. I have a lot of sad stories, but I remember each and all of them. I remember Henry Harris. He jumped off a building. He went to Auburn. He was a great player in the Rockwell Classic and committed suicide. You know, I have those people.
Look how you helped Kobe Bryant. I remember that.
Well, Kobe, I helped him do something, but Kobe was going to do something. If you ask me one person, you know, I'll say two persons now, right? Because I'm going to put LeBron in there. But Kobe, his mindset, I can relive with you being in the car, going from place to place. I can relive with you helping him find a home on top of the hill in Pacific Palisades when Pam and I own a little home down below the hill. I can know Joe and his Pam's wife. I remember Joe because he played in a round ball game. I remember Pam because her brother played in the round ball game a year later. I had a connection. Kobe and I, until we made the split, you know, we're the closest. We've done everything. But let me tell you about Kobe. If you ask me, and I'm saying this on your program here, one person who I would have bet then, because remember now, he left Adidas, went to Nike, and had a great thing, and probably sold more, you know, shoes. That was fine. It was a business decision. I said that on Soul Man. Kobe made business decisions. But his mind, it was always a business decision. Kobe was the smartest, and he also was the most competitive guy. That has nothing to do with Michael's competitive and doing whatever. You see, the difference between Kobe and Michael and probably LeBron, he was competitive in a worldwide thing that we didn't know anything about until he died. Those business deals that he was doing, the winning the Academy Award on the books, Kobe was in a different world. Always was. He come up to me at the first year at the camp, you know, and he apologized. He was a junior because I never seen him. His daddy brought him over to me. And he runs over him. He said, "Mr. Carroll, swear to God." "What, Kobe?" I said, "You did really well." I said, "No, Mr. Carroll, I want to apologize." "What are you apologizing for, Kobe?" "Next year I come to camp, I'm going to be the best player here." I said, "Kobe, you made the junior all-star team." "No, Mr. Garrett, I'm going to be the best player here." Well, the rest is history. He was. And he was the best player every time he played from the rest of his life. But not only was he the best player, and he had ups and downs as a human being. We both know that. I'm not going into them, as we all do. Mm-hmm. It's hard being God. It's hard being somebody, you know, it is.
I know. Okay?
You'll fall down. The key is, do you get up? The key is, do you repent and do you go forward and do good things? So I say to you, to your audience, and Kobe, when you put it all together, Kobe would have been a trillionaire. He would have owned everything. He opened the door for what LeBron's doing. Mm-hmm. He's opened the door what Kevin Garnett's doing, and mm-hmm. Seth Curry, and all the kids now, Chris Paul. Mm-hmm. Look what they're doing. That didn't happen with Michael. Great, unbelievable. Absolutely. But you know what, though? And I said this publicly. The only thing I know, when he had a chance to vote, he didn't vote against that guy in South Carolina. I know that.
So you're friends with George Gervin. You tell me some stories about George. I've always admired George Gervin. What kind of person is he?
George Gervin is one of my best friends in life.
Yeah, you're telling me, yeah.
And basically, I didn't know George Gervin. I sent a kid from my hometown, a football player, when I was coaching football in the 60s, to Eastern Michigan on a scholarship. So I'm now Senator Carroll. I got Ron Ball going and, you know, all these things. And I was representing some players. Remember I told you, ABA and all that sort of stuff. George punches a referee in the nose, okay, and knocks him out or some damn thing. So Jackson Nunn, my high school friend, and still a friend to this day, he was one of my advocates in Pennsylvania, just so you know that. Jackson Nunn. So he says, Sonny, I have a friend here that wants to go to that ABA, and he just got in some trouble and whatever. I knew who George was because my good friend Jerry Tarkanian was recruiting him. Hmm. But he didn't stay. He didn't want to stay. He wanted to go home. So he went home. He punches the guy. I drive from Pittsburgh to 10 or 11 mile road. Before Eminem had those miles, I always bring that up because it's funny. I drove there. I didn't know where I was going. I was going into Detroit. I get there. I finally get there. Jackson didn't meet me when whatever. I drove. And I knock on a door. And this big, tall, black man introduced. I'm saying that to specifically tell your audience. Nothing to do with blacks and Sonny and whatever. I've been around blacks all my life. Okay. So I'm saying to you, I walked there on 10 Mile Road and there's Willie Merriweather. He's 6'10". If you check him out, he was an All-American at Purdue University. And standing next to Willie on a chain was his big black Doberman. We still laugh. I just talked to Willie and Sam about a week ago. And, you know, and there was this meek-mouthed 6'7", thin as hell kid, George Gervin. And they said to me, Sonny, we need help. George wants to go to the ABA. George never played in college. Only thing they know about George, he hit the referee.
I didn't know that.
Oh, that's true. This happened. Call George. Get him on your program. Bring George.
Give me his number.
I represented him. I represented him. And I signed a contract. He went to Virginia Squires down in Virginia Beach. In a motel room on a napkin. That was the original client, an agreement between me and the Washington, what the hell they were at that time. They had Dr. J and those guys. That was a hell of a team. Just, you know, the ABA was just starting.
Wow, so, you have stories.
50 years later, the kid that they kicked out of Eastern Michigan, then they honored him. I kid him. I said, what the hell did you go back for? You went back and they put your name up there. They ran you out of town. And he says to me, and I ain't gonna say what happened. He said, Sonny, we're even now. And George points to his head and he says, because they treated him well when they put that up there. Now the guy they kicked out of school. They ostracized him. Now he goes back and he's up there and rap to George and to someone like me. And I understood. You rubbed that crap right in their faces. That's what you did. And the reason you did, because he was a great George Gervin. That's why they did. You know, if he wouldn't have been a great George Gervin, they weren't bringing him back to Eastern Michigan, putting that up on the wall. So I hope that helped. Mm-hmm. But George's family friend. Yeah. George's family friend.
You know, I got to ask you a few more questions. I got to ask a lot of questions before we get off the air. You know, people don't know, you and I talk once a week. We talk an awful lot, right? And you said something, right? I forget what basketball player. He had donated $1 million back to like Syracuse or North Carolina or Duke or one.
Carmelo Anthony.
Yeah, you was like, Norm, why don't they donate that back? Like, this school don't need it. Put it back in the community. Explain why you said that.
I told you that, and I told other people, and I'm glad you gave me the opportunity. I think the kids do that on a guilt thing, on a thing that, like, they think that university actually did something. Well, he went 1 year, and most of them only went 1 year at that time. And I don't mind them doing it. And I told Mello. And he told me why, you know, whatever, why. I don't care. I mean, he can do what he wants. It's his money. But for all these years, and I see Michael's doing a lot good now, and I'm happy that it took him a long time to do it, but I'm glad. I hope he gets $1 billion. Him and Phil Knight both. They give $2 billion. I want that to happen. I'm not against them.
Right.
I want them to happen. But I never understood black kids in that thing. They subconsciously think they have an obligation to a school that didn't give them an education. Now, this is different if you were one of those kids that went through and academically and whatever, and then you come out of nowhere. Carmelo Anthony was good at birth, just so we understand that. He was going to be in the Hall of Fame when he dribbled his first ball. Carmelo's was one of the greatest talents I've ever seen in my life. Hmm. And he did a video, and he went back to Baltimore, and he showed the video and all that sort of stuff. And you know, and I called him. I called Bebe, that's his personal manager, and I called him, and I said, you know, Bebe, that's good, but I'd rather we didn't do the video. We build a new rec center, or give, you know, $2.5 million or $250,000, whatever the hell they spent, to the community. See, I don't understand that. And that's what LeBron did, though. LeBron went back and started the school. He went back to Akron and Canton in that area. They ostracized. I was with them then. Hmm. Norman, one of the strongest mothers I've ever been in around my life. And I've been around all the mothers. All the mothers. And my wife was, you know, walked there, and I don't know if we have an enemy. I mean that. I guess some people that want to ostracize us, that I don't count them as nothing. But my point here, LeBron's mother is a stronger lady than I've ever met in my life. Hmm. I mean that. I don't think I've ever said this in this sort of thing. And I don't, that's not the thousands of other mothers. They all were. But what happens when you rise to the top with your son, with the story that preceded it with her son, and you know what she went through with her son, and you know what the city of Akron did with her son, mm-hmm. and the high school did with her son, mm. I know. I was there.
Hey, Sonny, we could talk for another hour and a few minutes, but guys like Dave Henderson, Mo Howard, Cisco, Rob, Oliver, Wayne Miller, and all these guys.
All those guys.
Wayne Chung and Shannon McCann's, who you brought into your camp. All these, I mean, Jermaine Mellis, Corey Curtis, all these guys wanted me to thank you personally. And there's so many names that I can't even think. And you would have no, I mean, you have no idea. I hope you do. The impact of the lives that you were able to touch. God has blessed you in more ways. Hold up, just hear me out. And I thank Pam and you know, my wife now, we talk about it. You've touched me, and I've cried over the phone with you just thanking you. And you just need to, I know you're humble, and sometimes it's hard for you to accept that, but please, for this moment, accept that so many people love you and we appreciate. I mean, when I was in Atlanta talking to those guys, and we sat around and talked, and they just were talking about you, brother. I mean, you have no idea. You have no idea. And so I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. Let me close it down.
If you're kicking me off, let me say this. All those kids' names you knew, and I knew Mo probably better anyway, because I knew Lefty at that time, and Raveling coached him, I think. But my point I'm saying just about Mo particularly is, like, there were so many kids in Philadelphia, so many kids that come up the hard way, and some of them had a stronger background than others. But I can remember those days when the Hill League first started, and 16th Street and all the other places. Like, I do remember St. Cecilia's and the Dust Bowl in Louisville. You see, Norman, the thing that they don't know, not these kids, is the public. I went there. Mm-hmm. I went there to meet the kids. So when I talk about Gloria, or I talk about, you know, all the mothers of the kids, we treated them like human beings. Mm. It wasn't like McDonald's, where they had to buy their own tickets, where they had to pay their way there's a sacrilege what McDonald's did to these kids. And I know it got big and all that stuff, but it was sinful. McDonald's, a $1 billion company, and they're making parents pay to get there, buy tickets, and all this bullshit over these years. This is what I rallied against. This is why those kids, to this day, because probably somewhere in their home, their mother and dad touched base with some of these events that the kids played in. And when you say Pam, you know, we ran into parents, you know, down at UCLA when Pam's sister was in the hospital, and I hadn't seen him for 35 years. I mean, and the kids will know all the names, and I'm not gonna use them here, but, you know, sometimes they turn out good, sometimes they turn out hard, and then sometimes very good, and then sometimes very hard. Life is a crapshoot. That's what I always thought, because I'm a gambler at heart. But you know what? When you get the dice in your hand, you're the one rolling them. when you throw the dice against that wall, you don't know what's coming up. Two aces or the six and an ace. Okay, you have no idea, Storm. And these kids don't either. But they can control that. If they get a chance, if they get a chance. That's all I wanted to ever do. They gave me a chance. And I get very sentimental and all that stuff. And I do because it's real. You know, I can remember Tony Sammartino and, you know, all the guys, the gum band guy, Mo Tamino, gum band guy, Joey Goldenberg, you know, one of the greatest high school basketball players I ever saw, and they played a minute or two in his life question, was Jimmy Baker. Jimmy Baker from Philadelphia was as good. Jimmy Baker had one of the greatest games in the history of the round ball, 37 points, and Maurice Lucas was on the same team in Pennsylvania. Jimmy got screwed up, and I stay in touch with Jimmy Baker to this day. To this day. And it's nothing that I can do or he can do for me. But what I'm saying, when you mention these kids' names, how the hell can you forget? But on the wings of those kids and their parents, Sonny, the Carol, and Pam got a chance to fly. They were the wind beneath my wings. So I can't, it's all the rest of the world. It's honesty. We got off on a tangent here. You turn me. I just talk and go.
No, but we appreciate you, Sonny. Thank you so very much for coming on the show. And I sent you a copy of the show. And again, thank you, Pam. I mean, again, I'm humble. I mean, you could see how I get when you and I talk. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed this interview. This is a good friend, a mentor. Like I started out, a brother, a father. It's meant a lot to me and the people here, not just in this state, but the 50 states. Thank you, Sonny.
I would like to end up here. You and Gary Charles were two young people to come into my life at different times, around the same thing, him coaching AAU kids and you just being this guy. And I watched both of you. So it just wasn't the athletes. It was people like you and Norman. There are a lot of people like you and Gary who have done well. That's why I'm so pissed off at the way the media and George Raveling and those people always demeaned the kids in these AAUs. What we did in the 90s and late 80s with the camps gave a chance for these kids to be. That's what I like. So all the naysayers, they gotta live with themselves.
Thank you so very much. Ladies and gentlemen, great Sonny Vaccaro. Thank you, Sonny.
What's up? Got to pay back. Revenge! I'm mad! Got to get back! I need some get back! Payback! Payback!